Hi, welcome to Inkscape for Teachers. Welcome to this Inkscape overview. This will be part one of possibly several parts. First, we'll open up Inkscape. If you need to download that, you can visit www.inkscape.org and download the appropriate version for your system. Now, one thing about Inkscape is it can sometimes take some time to boot up. Every now and then it might take, you know, 3 or 4 minutes, but usually it's about as quick as it was there. Now, the first thing I do usually when I open up is type 1 to zoom 1 to 1. If I hold the mouse wheel down and drag around, I can drag the page around. You can see that because of the border of the page moving. The other way to move around is just move the mouse wheel to scroll up or down. Holding down control zooms in or out, and holding down shift and mouse wheel zooms left and right. Now, you may not have this view, but I like to go to view and down to custom, and that way the snapping tools are at the top there, which I find quite convenient. Now, I also have a couple of dialogues open here. I'll actually just close them to show you how I find them. Close them all, I've got a lot open. Control Shift F brings up the fill and stroke, and that's probably the most useful dialog box. The other one is the align and distribute dialog box, Control Shift A. So I'll just go back to the fill and stroke one and we'll take it from there. The text tool is one of the most important tools. That's down here. You can see an icon for it, or I just simply type T and it'll activate the text tool. I then just click and type text as required. F1 for the select tool and click away. Now, if I want to reactivate that, I can double click it and enter that text field, go to F1, or I can just type T for the text tool and then enter there and select, or, you know, continue, move to a position where I want to continue, and so forth. Now, while I'm in the text field, the font and the style and the font size and so on are activated. For example, if I wanted to change to bold, I could do it up there, and the whole lot goes to bold, I don't have to select it. If I want to change the size, I can change that there as well. Go to F1. Another way, of course, is just to drag and drag it out of proportion. Control Z, or if you want to resize in proportion, about the center, Control Shift does that. It's just shift is not what we want, and control would do it in proportion, but shift means it's in proportion about the center. Okay, well, I've got that text there, I'll select it and show you how to duplicate things. If I type Control D, I've actually duplicated, I've produced a copy on top of the existing copy. You can see now if I drag it, you can see the original underneath. Control Z. If I hold down Control, it constrains it to horizontal, or, sorry, vertical or horizontal movement. Now there's a copy there. If I go Control C, it produces a copy and it pastes with the cursor in the center. So Control V, you see my cursor was in the center of the pasted section. If I wanted to group things together, I drag a marquee around them and Control G. Now I can move them as one entity, and that's very useful as well. If I decided I wanted to select something within that group, I could ungroup, or I can just go Control click and then I'm just in that section there. Or I might want to change the colour of just that section to red, for example. When I click away, now it's still grouped. So that's quite handy as well. If I wanted to rotate something, I click on it a second time. You see these handles have turned to curved. I can grab one and it rotates about the centre. You can see a little cross there. If I move that cross down to here and rotate it, rotates around that point now. So that's very handy as well. If you have several blocks of text or items or objects that you wish to align, The line and distribute menu is very, very useful. For example, if I select them in a marquee like that, and last selected is what I usually have, I want them left aligned, I click there, and it selects, left aligns them. Control Z. If I want them on a centered on each other, actually does the same thing there. That's a doesn't really show you too well. So what I'll do is I'll change this one to a bit of a longer section, and if I select them all and align the centers, you can see that's done. Or if I want them, let's go back to left align, but I want them spaced equally, you can do that. So that's very useful when you're setting out blocks of text or questions in a test. I'll just delete that by pressing delete on the keyboard, and back to T for the text tool, and I'll type show you how to type powers. So I wanted x squared plus 3x plus 1. I'll actually increase the size there. Now I really should have italics, so T for text tool, and just highlight and italicize by Control I and get italics. Oops, back to text tool. If I wanted a power there, I can use the superscript there. So that's quite handy as well. Let me just select that and delete to clear the page and show you the Bezier, some people might say Bezier pen tool. That's this tool here. If I click it or type B, I'll activate that. And if I want just a line, I just click the start. If I want it constrained to horizontal or vertical, I hold down Control, move, click, and then press Enter to finish. Click the select tool, click away, because it's quite a thin line, I'll select it again. Under stroke style, I can then bump that up to any thickness that I want. And I can also do things like put arrowheads on the end and so forth. That's very powerful as well. I can if I want to use a square root sign, for example, I could just draw it using the Bezier pen tool, like so. Just click, 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 controlled, constrained to horizontal, click and enter, and something like that. Now that may be good enough for what you want, or you may want to use Word's equation editor. If you're using a version that doesn't have that, you might have to install a trial version of MathType, which reverts to the old equation editor after time if you don't upgrade. And under the MathType tab, click inline, for example, find a square root template, which may be here, and file, close and return document 1, update that, yes, then click on it, Control C, return to Inkscape, Control V. I'll just Control Shift to increase the size, and there we have perhaps a more elegant square root sign. If I want to extend it, I can click on it and type N for the node tool, and just drag a marquee around those two nodes, then just click somewhere and Control Drag to extend the square root sign. So you may prefer that version. To obtain fractions, that's a bit fiddly, but once you've got some, you can then copy them. Text tool, type your fraction or your digit that's required. Again, I'll just enlarge that a bit. Probably best to have that centered, so T for the text tool, and then I can see the centering icon there. Back to the select tool, Control D, Control drag down. T for text to be able to edit it, change it to what you want. And the Bezier pen tool, click, click, Control to constrain horizontal, enter to finish it. Looks a bit thin for what I've got there, so you can increase the thickness to something that looks about right. Drag around it all, and under the align and distribute, select this one, align on a vertical axis, and distribute the vertical spaces, and Control G to group it. And once you've got one fraction, Control D to duplicate, and then T for text tool, and you can edit as required. So that's one way to obtain fractions. You can also use the Bezier pen tool to draw curves. If I click the Bezier pen tool, click, and if I then click and drag, I can produce a curve, and then click and enter. If you want to edit that while it's selected, N for the node tool, click the node you wish to edit, and you can change the gradient that way. It can be a bit daunting and a bit hard to get what you want with the pen tool, so it might take a bit of time. I mainly use it for straight lines, but you can use it for curves as such. I'll just Control A to select everything and delete to clear my page and show you some of the shapes. For example, the rectangle tool over here, click it, click and drag, and you can draw a rectangle. Click a colour, we'll fill it in. Shift click a colour, and that's the boundary colour. I'll make that more obvious by looking at the fill and stroke and increasing the width there. See, it's very powerful. You can get whatever combination of stroke colours and fill colours that you want. If I click on it again and type R for the rectangle tool, notice this little circle here. I can click on that and drag it to produce curved corners. If you want to go back to a straight corner, click this icon here. That's quite convenient. It's still actually a rectangle. It's not an actual path. Sometimes you need to turn it into a path. I'll show you the difference. If I go Path, Object to Path, and now if I click N or type N, you can see each corner is an actual node, and that way you can drag things around and produce all sorts of shapes. If you Control click, you can even change it to curved and fiddle around there. Control Z to go back. I'll just delete that. The ellipse tool, or circles and ellipses. If you want a circle, hold down Control as you drag. You can still get multiples like 2x1 ellipses, but you'll also get amongst that perfect circles. Control Z or Control Shift, I prefer, produces it from the ends, from the centre outwards. Again, I'll increase the border width to 1 millimetre. So make that blue by Shift Blue. I can fill it in with yellow again by clicking the fill colour, and it's a circle. Now if I go E for ellipses, you can see these little circles here. This is very convenient for drawing arcs and segments and sectors in Inkscape. If I drag that around on the outside, I can produce sectors. If I drag it on the inside, segments, and you can drag either one of those around to get some good effects. Useful for marking angles, for example. If you've got that and you want it back to a circle, type E for ellipses, and you can either go to the segment or the full circle again using these icons up here. I'll just draw a couple more shapes now to show you some other tools. Again, just bump up the stroke size, perhaps shift click, make it pink, and green for the fill, and show you by dragging shapes over each other and shift clicking to select more than one shape. Under the path menu, go path difference, and that's the bit that wasn't common, punches a shape through the first shape. The top shape punches down through the first shape. I'll Control Z show you that again. Yeah, so this one is like the cookie cutter and punches through the one underneath. So if you have to have them both selected, and path difference. Back to Control Z. If I select them both, go path intersection, then it's the bit where they overlap is shown, and the attributes of the first shape. Control Z. Another interesting one, path union. Oops, haven't selected them both. Path union, and it produces one shape that's a union of both. And again, the first drawn shape is the one that the attributes are taken from. Control Z, select them. What else have we got? Path division. Okay, it's interesting. Yeah, it produces shapes where the lines overlapped. Control Z to go back. And finally, path, cut path. And you see the difference there. We'll just cut the first path. That can be handy as well. When drawing, it's often easier to start with circles, ellipses, and rectangles than trying to draw them with the Bezier pen tool. One of the other dialog boxes I like is the transform dialog box. Control Shift M, think of move, one of the key transformations. Now if I'll just draw another rectangle, fill it with red, select tool, under move I can enter say 20 millimeters and then apply that move, or I can duplicate first and apply the move and move lots of things by a consistent amount if I want things evenly spaced, for example. Maybe if I'd made that 100, select it, Control D, apply, and so on, you can see it spaces things out. You can also scale under here. If you want to scale it proportionally, 200%, click the tick the box there and apply, and it becomes twice as big. That's quite handy as well. If you want to rotate something by set amount, let's say I wanted to rotate it about the corner rather than the center, click on the object twice, you see this little cross, and drag it to the corner. It's not snapping, so I need to activate this snap the rotation center. If I move it now, it snaps there. Now if I say enter 30 degrees up here and apply that transformation, keep applying it, you can get some effects, or you can duplicate and apply and get some interesting shapes. Yeah, so that's a very powerful one as well. Skew and matrix, well, it's a bit more complicated. I'll leave those ones for now. I'll just select and delete that. Mouse wheel up and control held down zooms in. One thing I find useful too is using the page grid, view page grid, and if this icon snap to grid is on, that's handy for if I click and you want exact dimensions of rectangles, or you want lengths, click and click and enter, and you can duplicate, Control D, and drag things down, they snap, Control D, and you can generate your own grids and things pretty nicely using that. I'll turn it off for now. View a page grid turned off, and again delete that. Just a word about some extensions in Inkscape. It's worth having a look under extensions. For example, render, and you can, there's a function plotter, triangle construction there. You can see I've entered side lengths and angles, apply and close, and you can draw triangles that you want in a certain proportion or certain dimensions. Control shift and drag to the size that you want if you need to resize that. I'll just give that a fill. Now, a lot of people won't have Inkscape and you'll have produced diagrams using them or documents, so you might want to just do File, Save As, and select under here PDF. I'll save it to the desktop. Click Save. 300 dpi is a good resolution. OK. Then if you actually go to close that, I'll say I click close without saving it. It is saved as a PDF. I don't want the other Inkscape file saved. I'll close Word. I had that open before. And I'll find on the desktop the PDF. There it is there. If I double click, that opens pretty quickly. And there's a PDF version. The same control zoom or drag around works in PDFs. Control mouse wheel up zooms up, or just the hand tool to move down. But PDFs is a good way of sharing your files and printing with surety that things are going to print as displayed. Now, if you want more information, please look at the other videos in my Inkscape for Teachers channel, or in YouTube, do a search for a guy called Photo Advanced 2. He has some excellent tutorials on Inkscape. Or check my website, www.maths-pro.com. Hope this has been useful, and as always, thanks for watching.